What I will do is to recollect some things we have already talked about. And find a kind of summary for what we have done. But at the same time, that is quite typical for summaries, we will actually see the restriction of this summary in terms of a metaphysical reconsideration of all of that, and this will then close our program. Now, first of all, I have to correct myself from what we did at the end yesterday, because as I quoted you, I think that was about page 35 or something, namely with respect to the city models. Yesterday I mixed up the Betancourt with the Betty, in fact, so Jose Maria was actually right in wondering about that, because the star model I've mentioned is actually due to Betancourt, while Betty was dealing with fractality, but because I discussed it the other way around yesterday, I confused these two, but of course, if you look into the lecture notes, you can recognize that quite easily. The second point is that I have to do now a kind of historical reminiscence, because all of what we have said about the city is of course not falling from heaven, so to speak, in a moment, but is the result of the complete development of the modern European city, which is actually originating in northern Italy. Now, the point is that the origin is very illustrative, because it's actually of Roman descent. As you might remember, I mentioned that the first city system in European culture, but when you remember, when I'm speaking of European culture, I also mean Asian and African culture, so actually what I mean is East Mediterranean culture. And the first city system, based on the expansion of trading networks in terms of Phoenicians, was actually the Greek polis system. And the important point was that each polis was an autonomous institution, such that it was self-administering and it was self-governing, so to speak, although it had, of course, certain links to the mother city, to the metropolis. But this was more a question of mentality rather than practical politics. So what we had was a widespread network of polis, such that actually, that is a somewhat curious aspect, the longer the distance, the tighter the links to the metropolis. In other words, in that network, this network was obviously a spatial network, but it acted as if it would be beyond space and time. You see, the bonds with the origin were very tight, and somehow the distance between the metropolis and the recently founded polis was practically forgotten. So, in that sense, you can say that the polis, which was, for instance, founded in the east of Spain, or a polis which was erected in the Cyrene in Libya, or a polis somewhere in Italy. Of course, in Italy, the colonization has actually started. This was practically a kind of permanently present and non-temporal construction, such that it was considered to be just in the vicinity or the neighborhood, so that the very long distances, you have to think that it was a very long time to sail from one point to the other, that these distances were actually neglected. The reason is that contrary to us nowadays, the ocean had a different function. You see, nowadays we think of an ocean as a kind of boundary of the country. So that when we go, for instance, in Germany up to the northern and the eastern sea, then we come to the boundary of the continent. Not to speak of the English. On the other hand, that is similar here. If we come to the coast, then we are at the Atlantic or at the Mediterranean. But for those people in ancient times, the ocean was actually the mediator. So it was not a boundary, but it was rather the real substance. While the country settlements were just at the boundary, at the edge of this mediating system. Yeah? So the water, thalassa, was actually the real thing, while all the rest was not so important, and it was just operating in daily life. So this viewpoint is very decisive for the functioning of the small world models in terms of ancient Greek settlements. And the stability of a network and so is not so dependent on the geographical distance, but rather on the mentality which is practically inherited from the mother city, from the metropolis. Now, as I said, the Romans changed that because although they took the polis system as a kind of skeleton, so that a Roman province is practically a piece of country with a capital in between. Yeah? You see, however, the difference already. So this is Roman, and contrary to Greek, because the Greek settlement was typically at the seaside, at the beach, so to speak. And the important point was the communication with the ocean. So what you had was, you had two markets. The central market in the city, Agora, and you had the harbor market, which was a kind of cross market, you know, so that when the ships came, that they had to pay their fees and all that, and that was then discharged at the harbor, what they brought, and from there transported into the marketplace of the city for actually selling. Yeah? So they had an exterior and an interior marketplace. And as I said, the other pole of the agora was the theatron, actually regulating the governing of the city. Now, on the other hand, each polis had something which we can actually call, in modern language, we can call logo, you see, in terms of propaganda and advertisements. At that time that was not so important, but in a sense it was actually the origin of that. For instance, if you think of Athens, then the logo of Athens was obviously the Acropolis. But you see, the Acropolis, and actually I call that logos, namely with respect to the former expression topos, although in anglicized language nowadays you could actually talk of a logo, but we mean actually a logos. And the Acropolis is actually the core of Athens, referring to the cultural period which was preceding the polis period. Yeah? Because when the Acropolis was built, that was the culture of Mykenae, and then that was the time when the people had kings and all that sort, which was not the polis organization, which is quasi-democratic. Yeah? So this Acropolis refers directly as a concrete building to the times which were, as compared to the polis age, prehistoric. And that is actually the time which in Homer is being topical in terms of the war of Ilion or Troia, because all these people like Agamemnon, Odysseus, and so on, they are supposed to be kings of their small province, you know. And of course they lived in a kind of palace in the Acropolis, and you see that even better in Mykenae, in the archaeological excavation. The Acropolis is practically the king's palace with functional buildings around in order to take care of the living standard and so on. And of course, therefore, it's a nucleus for the further settlement, because all the other people obviously used to settle around it, because on the other hand, the Acropolis was also a fortification. So, the idea now of the logo is not so much that the Acropolis would have had a useful function at the time of classical Athens, because it was simply a temple of Athena, which was the protector of the city, of course. But the point is that if you walked through the ancient city, and you know, always fine weather, the sun was shining and so on, then, independent of where you were located in the city, you could always look up at the Acropolis, which was illuminated, of course, because it was on a high mountain, was illuminated by the sun shining over the city. So, in other words, someone who was a citizen, the pure citizen of Athens, had a kind of reinsurance, you see, when he was walking. Everyday life, nothing in particular, just was walking through the streets, then he had a kind of permanent reinsurance that he is of a certain importance because he is a citizen of this particular city, you see. And of course all the other polis tried to do something similar, and in fact they had, but most of the time they did not have a Acropolis, of course, sorry, but what they had was, for instance, a famous theater or so. So if you come, for instance, to Barcelona, you have an old Roman theater, which is very nice, open air, of course, a Greek theater, I mean. And the Romans later on took that as a kind of tradition, because the Greek culture was obviously very important for the Romans. Remember that Italy was colonized by the Greeks around 750 BC, and of course there were already people available called Etruscans, and in Etruria, in the north of Rome, these people had a kind of industrial revolution whilst the Greeks were arriving, because the Greeks brought manufactured things, instruments, machines and all that from other countries, not from Greece, but for instance from the Phoenicians or from the Egyptians. And so the Etruscans learned that there are instruments they didn't actually know. So for them it was a kind of industrial revolution, and actually they themselves continued trading up to the north of France, you know, because they used the river Rhone as a transport channel, and they brought all these things, and you can show that in archaeological terms, all these modern ideas that they brought up to the north of France in the middle of later Gallia, so to speak. Now, as I said, the Romans took this idea as a skeleton, but they also governed the country around. So for a polis, in the traditional sense, the cultural environment was only important in order to have a certain amount of agriculture, which was actually taking care of what a city would actually need to eat and to drink, you know. But the Romans did that in a larger dimension, which meant that they were actually separating the harbors from the cities, from the provincial capitals. And in the provincial capital was situated a kind of statue which was representing the government of Rome. Not always the statue of an emperor, because it was a later Roman time, but in the times of Roman Republic, it was nevertheless a symbol which practically symbolized the presence of the government of Rome. And so what we have here is a transition that takes place after Rome has actually defeated Carthago, which was the last large Phoenician colony, and governed the Mediterranean, and then later on actually conquered Greece and all that, which is around 150 BC. And that is a time where the network city system is actually going over into a country city system, meaning a country state is actually replacing the city network state. And the hierarchy is quite obvious. I mean, of course, you have a province and you have the procurator, who is the boss of the province, but the set of procurators has, of course, a boss in the consuls in Rome, two of them all the time, and later on, of course, this is replaced by the emperor. Now, the structure, however, is quite, of the city, is quite different as compared to the Greek polis, because the Greek polis was harmonizing the architecture of the city in terms of the two poles I mentioned, between agora and theatron. So you can see that actually quite clearly in Athens, where the traditional agora is actually built in terms of useful chosen arcades. Yeah, so you have a large marketplace in the middle, and then you have arcades around which are open to the inside. And the idea is that this follows the climate, you see. I mean, according to the state of the sunlight, you are always sitting in a relative warm surroundings. Yeah? So if it is the summer, for instance, it's very hot and the sun is shining very strongly, then you have shadow. Otherwise, in the winter, when it's comparatively cold, it's nevertheless warm because it's shielded from the wind and all that, you see. So that is actually the first invention of the coffee houses without coffee. Huh? Now, the point is that the Greek polis is an open system, while the Roman system is closed. You see, the agora in Greek polis, is replaced directly by what the Romans call a forum. That is exactly the same, but it is completely different in structure because the forum is closed. Now the idea is that the agora is open, I mean, of course, except where the arcades are being built, because the idea is to signal that everyone may come and trade, you see. And actually the king of Persia had always difficulties with that because he complained to his people that the Greeks are very curious. They have in public place, in the square, a large square in the city, where one can actually cheat the other. You see, I mean, because the trading means that you try to sell very few, very little for very much money, you see. So he was wondering what kind of institution that is, where the people are meeting in order to cheat each other, you see. And but that is the idea. It's open to everyone who is coming, of course, who is following the rules of trading, but clear, yeah. So the agora is typically a place of tolerance. And although the Greeks are calling everyone who is not speaking Greek barbaros, yeah, and the meaning of barbaros means simply babbling. Yeah? These are people who cannot speak properly. They can only babble things we cannot actually understand. But so that is obviously very subjective. And in the colonies, because they very often married women of the local people living there, but they never learned the language of the local people. The women and, of course, the children had always speak Greek. But the point is that, nevertheless, the agora is a place where you learn that there are very many different people in the world, and you have actually to accept this. And if someone is loud, you don't wonder. If someone is saying nothing at all, you are not wondering, and so on. So that is a characteristic of the city for 2,000 years, that the city altogether on the average is always more tolerant than the countryside, because you have so many people and they are obviously quite different, and you are actually not wondering, if you are living in the city, you are not wondering that they are different, and therefore it's more peaceful, yeah, because you would not take that as an aggression or provocation, actually. Whilst, of course, in the theatron, if there is the ecclesia, you know, and we have to do concrete political decisions, that is, of course, not a place for tolerance, yeah, because there you have to follow your objectives. But the Roman Forum is quite different because it is not thought for everyone. Yeah? Because the Romans don't have a democratic society like the Greeks, they have an aristocratic society. So only particular people are actually part of that. You see, in Athens, of course, also particular people, as I said, adult men who were actually free, I mean, who did not have any debts and so on. About 6,000 people in Athens, for instance, but in Rome it were quite fewer people, because they had to be of aristocratic origin, independent of their merits, and there was a difference between the aristocracy and the people, populus. If you go to Rome, then you can actually observe this, because there is a number of different forum buildings, because each emperor later on would like to show that he is the best and richest and so on. But all of them are built in a closed style, so that it is even not arbitrary to enter them, because you are led a particular way, because whilst going over this way, this route, particular route, it shall be demonstrated that you can look at the magnitude of Rome, which is obviously quite different from the Athenian institution. And the second point is that the Roman city is organized according to military principles. And that is simply the case because, obviously, Rome has conquered quite a lot, namely everything between Scotland and Persia and North Africa. And the idea is that everywhere where there is a settlement, the soldiers of the legion were first. So a city or a settlement in Roman terms is, in the first place, nothing but a location where the legion is actually resting and fortifying itself. So the idea is that you have a very simple geometrical system you have two main roads which are governing that, and of course then here this has a certain hierarchy of smaller pathways, and this is the location where the soldiers have their little houses, huts, tents or whatsoever, where the horses are, and so on and so on. And at the intersection, in the center, you have the commander, you have the financial offices and everything like that, the administration, and actually the forum. The forum is obviously the seat of the administration, the location of public assemblies, the trading point for people who live nearby, and so on and so on. Yeah, so it's a kind of military agora, so to speak. And of course around that you had either palisades or you had a wall of stone, yeah, depending on how old actually the settlement is. And of course it has a certain size, minimal size, because a legion would have on the average 4,500 men, which means in fact, in ideal terms, it should have 6,000, because it was divided into 10 departments or compartments of 600 men. But mostly this was not actually the case. So you can think of 4,500 men who settled there for the first time. And while doing so, they were attracting other people, of course, who settled nearby in order to do trading or anything like that. So this type of military settlement or fortification, in fact, is the nucleus of any Roman settlement of that kind, the core of the future city, so to speak. And because, as we can clearly recognize, this is a division into four parts, each part is obviously a quarter of the totality, and therefore this is called the quarter, the living quarter in which you actually live. And this has been taken up to the centuries, because the modern city, modern in the Renaissance sense of Italy, yeah, I'm speaking about the 12th century, the modern city is actually taking up this system, but because this modern city is larger than just one Roman settlement, so they take more than one of these squares, yeah, so they are adding up others of the same type. And then there is a difference, because when the people are comparatively rich, they will have obviously bigger houses, they will have gardens and all that. If they are relatively poor, they will have small flats in smaller houses. So in fact, the difference between rich and poor is clearly demonstrated in the morphology of the quarters, because here the streets are fewer and larger, and here the streets are smaller and denser. And this is actually, over the centuries, the same structure which arrives in modern times in the 19th century, at the beginning of the 19th century in Paris. So you see that although Paris is actually not a Roman foundation, but it had a Roman settlement later on, but the same system, only deformed according to the later on developments, according to the differentiation of of the population living here, this is what is coming out 1,000 years later. But you see, the real modern city emerges with the city of Bologna in 1115. 1115 is the official date of the foundation of the Comune di Bologna, but of course, you know, in historical terms, it's not so sure whether that was 1115 or perhaps 1112. But the university was celebrating a jubilee, namely, I think 900 years or something, which was referring to a date which was much earlier. And this cannot be the case, actually, so because otherwise the university should be older than the city, which is very unlikely. So you can actually assume that the commune was officially built in 1115, and that is about the same time when the first university in Europe was actually founded. Notice that it is the first university in the modern European sense, because that is unique, while of course an academy for people who would actually be counseling the king or anyone else, that is not a European invention, yeah, because the Chinese had their academies and all other people. And of course, before 1115, there were already academies elsewhere, for instance, in Cordoba, Spain, and so on, you know. But that is not the type of university which is meant here, because the difference of the University of Bologna is that it is self-organized. Yeah? It's a kind of democratic institution where the members say what happens, and not the reigning government of the country, or the king, or the pope, or whoever. The interesting point is that this was only possible in Bologna, because Bologna was the only city that was neither depending on the emperor, who was then the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire of German nation, as you might remember, yeah, one of the many Charles of one or the other kind, and they were also not depending on the Pope. So that was a sensation at that time, because in 1115 we are in the times of what is called the quarrel of investiture, which means the emperor and the pope were quarreling about the question who is actually intronizing the emperor, he himself or the pope, you see. And Bologna is actually the only place where the emperor and the pope met on neutral soil, because the emperor at that time said, well, he would actually like to visit the Pope, but then unfortunately he would have to bring his army also. Yeah? And the Pope was not very happy about that, so he better went from Rome to Bologna in order to meet the emperor there. And if you go to Bologna, then when I was a fellow there, I met Umberto Eco, and he has a private university in Bologna. And this university where he gives certain lectures, there's an auditorium with a very nice wall fresco painting. And this painting shows you the meeting of the Pope and of the Emperor. Yeah, so one came from one gate and the other from the other gate, and they met in the middle in the Piazza Maggiore, and you see everything according to ritual. But in reality, of course, the emperor was on the strong side. Now, the idea is here that that the structure of the city of Bologna is actually something new in so far as what is organizing there are actually professional groups. So you have the group of people doing some handicraft, or you have the people of traders, or you have people who produce something whatsoever. And the members of the university are simply also a group of people who are producing something which is only more abstract than the rest, because they are talking about important questions and they're publishing that, you see. So that is the creation of the intellectual, because in former times you had similar people, but these were mostly monks or so, and monks were universally working. I mean, they were also planting and drinking much wine and so on, you know. But they were not intellectuals, because intellectuals, by definitions, are people who think about problems, talk about them, and write them down, and live by that. That is the important thing. Yeah, the monk would not live by his scriptures, but the intellectual would do. The first intellectual in history might be Abelard, who lived at the university in Paris. And he is actually the founder, because he was a very young student at the time, and the people were quite angry, because the first he did was criticizing his professors, you see. So what he did was, he went out of the university, which was in Notre Dame at the time, and he founded his own university on the other side of the river. That was what is nowadays called the Sorbonne, you see. And he was the first one who actually lived by his job, although he was also of church descent. I mean, he was a priest, effectually. But you see, this is a different sort of professional approach now, and the democracy is not really a democracy as we know it, but it is a kind of professional democracy, because there are the groups who are communicating. Yeah, and deciding about buildings in the city and all that. And the university people are simply one of these groups, nothing in particular. And the first topic, in fact, which was taught was Roman law. Not church law, Roman law, because Roman law came from Milan to Tuscany. It was actually a result of the Germanic migration, because the Langobards, who are the name givers for the Lombardi, they were quite fond of Roman law. So that was the reason why Roman law was settled first at the University of Bologna as a single topic. And later on you had, beside law, you had medicine, and you had philosophy, and what else? I think four of them. Law, philosophy, medicine,
theology.
Okay, yeah, of course. And well, I always keep forgetting theology. And the system was such that when you were a student, for the first years you had to learn a general studies curriculum, which was comprising of all what we know otherwise, like physics, mathematics, music, and so on and so on. That was a kind of foundation of educating. And then you did your baccalaureus, your bachelor, and afterwards you studied your main topic, which was one of the four, and then you did your doctor examination, and that was a typical career. And when you come to Bologna, in the old building of the university, which is now the university library, the Archiginnasio, you can sit in the reading room and you see at the wall all the emblems characteristic signs of the families, the sons of which were actually studying there. Of course, at the time, only sons, and only rich sons, yeah, because as a student you had to finance yourself, in fact. And you see, that is the important point. By doing so, the university became an economic factor, because you see, all those students from all over the world, of course of the European world, coming to study in Bologna and later on in Padua, which is the second university, they were paying themselves, of course. And they came for a particular professor. So if the professor had difficulties with the governing administration of the city, then he simply went away to another university. But by doing so, he took all his students out of the university. So they lost the whole income of these people, you see. So that was the reason why the university became a certain autonomy in the beginning, to make sure that people would not migrate away, you see. And the first universities in Europe of that type, in about 250 years, since 1115, were Bologna, Padua, Paris, and Oxford. These are the four oldest universities. All the others, especially the German universities, came much later. So, what is true for the university organization is also true for the general organization. So, the Bologna people are actually introducing something new to that Roman type of settlement, which we can call fractality. Or as I have said, these cities are practically poly-centered center cities. You know, they have a center, like Bologna has an historical center, but the center itself is differentiated in various smaller centers according to the original professional group which was governing it. Yeah, so when you would like to buy something for clothing, then you went into a particular part of the center because that was the location where all these people lived who were actually producing cloth. While if you would like to have a good meal, then you had to go into another place. Yeah. So you have to see, first of all, we have the Greek network city, which is from 750 to 150 BC. Then we have the Roman country city, so to speak, according to the military settlement system. And then the Roman Empire, about 500, is going down, disappearing, and then actually the city is disappearing. You know, the migration period is typically a period which is not very favorable for cities. So there is actually a long interval of roughly 500 years. And then with Bologna, the modern version of a city is emerging. You see, actually Bologna is quite different from Florence because Florence is professionally organized in a different way. It's very similar to Venice, which is a kind of aristocratic society, top-down, yeah? While Bologna is bottom-up. Yeah, and then you have roughly 700 years more, and then you are in the modern times of Paris. So that is, Paris is the capital of the 19th century. Yeah? And why is that so? Because in Paris, all the new types of living together in the city are actually invented, which are added to all the others. You see, that is actually a dialectical process, as I mentioned in the beginning, that all the old aspects are actually sublated in the new aspects. So, the polis network system, which is a skeleton for the Roman city, the military settlement system, the fractality of Bologna, and so on, is sublated in what comes forward in modern city. Now, fractality in Bologna, so as I said, is the center in the center in the center, yeah? That is that you recognize the same structure in magnifying, so to speak, the surroundings. All of these aspects from Greek, Roman, and Italian times you can find in Paris, plus the innovations. And the innovations you can summarize in two words, namely boulevard representation and verticality. Verticality means that now people start to build their houses upwards. So typically about 1830 or from 1830 on, The houses in Paris have 4 stories, if not 5, and they have even on the roof, they have certain flats. And what was before the region of the quarter, where you could differ between rich and poor people, you can now differ in vertical direction, because the rich people live in the first floor, which is La Belle Etage, large flats, bright, open, and so on. And if you come upstairs, up to the roof, the people become poorer and poorer, and the flats become smaller and smaller. And on top of the roof, usually, poor artists and intellectuals are actually living. Yeah? That is no different from today. And the second point is that the ancient city of Paris is practically destroyed in the 19th century in favor of wide and modern avenues. Of course, that has actually a political reason, because the French people thought that it would be easier to get the military there if there is an uprising, you see. And you could not build very easily barricades if you would have a wide boulevard rather than a small street. But the point is that whilst building these boulevards, which should represent, of course, the force and power of France, quite clearly, especially of the emperor, the point is that you have an infrastructure which was absent before, because in former times, for instance, in the arcades of Bologna, you had all the shops and so on, so that the living started on top. That is the reason why you build arcades, because then you can gain space if you go upstairs, yeah, because you can use practically the roof of the arcades for flats. But here now, in the boulevard, this is enlarged considerably, and at the same time the economic development leads to a new type of selling, because normally you would buy your goods, sell the goods, and if you don't have any more, then you order new ones and sell them again. But now, what you are doing is, you order them permanently, and you are not measuring the type or the sample of a product according to your price, but what you are measuring is the circulation of the products. So, for instance, if you have a very little profit per round of circulation, then having 10 or 12 circulations during the year, you will have much more profit than before if you are actually ordering the products one by one. Yeah? So that is actually the invention of the great magasin, the department stores. And the first is Lafayette, that is of course very famous still today. And obviously the institution of department stores kills small stores because they do not follow. So the dimension of the shops, so to speak, and of the accompanying institutions such as coffee houses, restaurants and so on, theaters, that is widely enlarged and creates a new type of culture, so to speak, at that time. Practically this is the complete development of the modern city up to our own century. But of course you see that our own century reproduces all of these same structures plus their own innovation, but the innovation is not more in terms of buildings or so, although of course we can build high houses now than other people could not before, but that is not very important, it's only a gradual difference. But the important difference is that that the city extends now in virtual space. Yeah, so you can connect all these houses with various you know, that modern technologies we like so much, and you see that this is creating a kind of virtual picture of the city in different perspectives. Yeah, even if you are not a member of Second Life, it is already a kind of Second Life after all. But all the other elements have not been lost, they are still available. So if you go to the museum in the afternoon, then the important point is that you can visualize the origin, because Lyon is actually a Roman settlement, and you can reproduce this very fundamental structure in the same manner. And from there you can actually, if you look simply at the development of Lyon, you can practically reproduce all these aspects in detail, because all these aspects, of course, with a certain amount of years in delay, are actually approaching other cities, from Paris to Madrid, but then from Madrid, of course, to all cities of the provinces, and so on and so on. The new aspect, perhaps, is that this is not so much an internal development anymore, but it's also, to great parts, a development which is taken over from other countries. That is, of course, something in the former centuries you would not have, actually. So that has to do with long-range communication and all that. Okay, so that should be the historical excursion, in order to give you some historical background for this city development. Okay, so I'm coming now to the vielleicht können wir jetzt das nochmal anschauen. I'm coming now back to the detailed city structure once more. Because I thought it might be interesting for you once more to look in more detail to the question what you could actually do with the Petrinet modeling of social groups in urban quarters. You see all these aspects, like the logo of a city, like special places, topophilia, as they are called. Yeah, these are locations where people like to be because, for instance, of personal experiences or so. And of course, there are various other forms of locations. Foucault, for instance, introduces locations of a particular public kind. For instance, cemeteries or something like that, which have a special function, but which you, for instance, could use as a kind of part of your personal topophilia, yeah? Because some cemeteries look like parks or gardens or something like that. Yeah? Or you would like to think of the past or the future or whatsoever. So all these typical types of location, which are of course depending on your personal ontological space, they are mirrored, so to speak, in the overall city structure, and of course they will also be mirrored in the personal behavior of members of certain social groups we called species or complexes as to that. Okay, I will look from the page. Yeah, and I should come then, 67. And I should come back at the topological, the ontological space, as I mentioned yesterday, also quoted by Sartre. The idea was that this is, especially in the childhood, a space which is actually determining, or primarily determining, your socialization. And in the case of the novel of looking for the time lost, which is a recherche de temps perdu by Marcel Proust. This is exemplified in a particular way because it starts with remembering the childhood where the protagonist as a boy would go in, during summertime to the seaside with the family, and the house has actually two different exits, and one exit is leading up to a walk they do usually on Sundays, which is leading to one direction, and the other exit is leading to the other direction. And according to what kind of walk they are doing, they are leaving the house by the one or the other exit. Now, one walk leads to the area where Swan is living, and the first girl this boy encounters is the daughter of Swan, Gilberte, and it's there where he meets her for the first time, and later on she will be his girlfriend in Paris, but of course a couple of years later. On the other side, the walk leads to the palace of the family of the Garmont, which is an aristocratic family, and this family plays also a particular role because the protagonist will belong to that circle of the family, and of course all these families are modeled according to really existing families, because actually Marcel Proust indeed moved in these circles. Of course the names are changed and so, but I think that the French at the time would be actually able to recognize who was meant. And in the meantime, there's a lot of literature about the question who was who, you know, so that is quite clear. Now, the point is that then he describes his youth and older age and so on. And then he has, in principle, he has two main relationships, one with Gilbert and one with Albertine. The point is that Gilbert is actually, that is the daughter of Swan, but Swan, and that is part of the first volume, has actually married a prostitute, you see. And the point is now that Swan is belonging to these societal circles, but it is impossible to receive this woman, you know. So that is very brilliant, because you see, the woman, Odette, is actually, of course, trying to, on the long run, to become the wife of Swan, because she knows that Swan is very rich and so on, and has these societal connections. He, however, is very jealous and so, and he knows that she has different other relations and so, and obviously she has, because she is a prostitute, but he would not actually agree to that and so on and so on. But in the end, that is very interesting, in the moment he is sure that he is not loving her anymore, he is actually marrying her, you see. So that is a kind of taking the document, you know, to the archive in that sense. But so the point is that both of them have actually realized what they wanted, but both of them have failed at the same time. Because Odette was successful in marrying him, but she cannot gain anything from that marriage because she is not received in the famous houses. But Swan has loved her very dearly, but you see, that is not lasting. And so he takes that as a kind of economic duty, something like that. And so he owns her, so to speak, but that doesn't help him because he is not loving her anymore. So the product of that is Gilbert. Yeah? And obviously Gilbert cannot be received in the houses too, because she is a child of that woman. But in the meantime, the society is changing, because we are talking about the beginning of the 20th century. And so, step by step, Gilbert is practically introduced into these families, you know, and finally she is actually marrying someone from that, so that she herself is changing to the side of the Garmont. So in the end, what the protagonist is actually seeing is, and in old age he once more repeats these famous walks from his childhood, because now the side of Swann, and that is the reason why the chapters are called Du côté de chez Swann, which means in French, the side, in geographical terms, the side, but also in societal terms, the side of Swann and the side of Garmont, Du côté de chez Garmont. So the point is that in the end, when he is of old age, then these two sides have been brought together to be one side, because this one side has in the meantime mixed with the Garmont side, you see. And when he is replacing reproducing his work, then this can, for his personal biography, can be visualized as a kind of unification of two components who were actually determining his own biography. Yeah. So it's a very elegant construction, actually 4,000 pages, so you have a lot to read. But the important point is that this title, especially in the first volume, Du côté de chez Swann and Du côté de chez Garmont, is nothing but a mirror of the ontological space. Yeah? Because really the concrete walking is representing the concrete development of the biography in time. So space is translated into time and vice versa. And this is the reason why the walk at the end of the novel is actually time regained. Yeah, the lost time of the biography is regained by doing so. Okay, so now I come finally we have started at 67, I think. Yeah, 67.
Ah.
Yeah, okay. I will just... we go back to a passage where we were talking about the fact that Petri nets are actually representing reaction networks. So the reason was that for our terminology, we have actually chosen a terminology from chemistry, because that is very illustrative for our purposes. You see, normally you have in chemistry reaction schemes like that. Yeah, A, B, C are certain chemical stuff whatsoever. So you can say A is reacting to become B, B is reacting to become A back, and A plus C is reacting to become D, and so on. And everything with a plus here is called a complex. In fact, that has a double meaning, because for chemists, complexes are actually very difficult to discuss, because it's not simply an adding of compounds, but it's more a very complicated interaction. So that is a chapter for itself. But for us it's important that if you replace this by social groups, you would say A, B, C are species, meaning groups of individuals, and A plus C or B plus E are complexes in the sense that they are hyperspecies, yeah? groups of people.
Species are
the groups, ABC, groups of individuals, circles and the complexes A plus C or B plus E are groups of groups, so they are hyperspaces, so to speak. And you see that this is translating quite nicely into the social domain, because you see, if one group interacts with the other group, then this interaction takes place, of course, by single persons of these various groups, so that in detail the forming of a complex is actually very complicated, but what is counting is the result, namely that you have a coalition of two different groups. That is the point. So what a coalition would expect is quite clear, because you would expect that according to certain topics, these groups are doing the same. Now this can be actually this can be actually visualized exactly by a Petri net like this one. That is identical with the reaction graph I've shown before. That is a translation into Petri nets. Remember that the squares are dealing with the interaction, and the round circles there are actually standing for the species. And you see now that complex building is one particular interaction which is showing up here. So what we can do then is to actually read this in detail. This is what you can find in the lecture notes on page 68. So a reaction network is a graph whose vertices are labeled by complexes. And on the other hand, a reaction network can also be visualized as a set of species together with a directed multigraph. Multigraph means that you have more than one arrow coming out, whose vertices are labeled by complexes of those species. And in this sense, the reaction network is a generator of a Petri net and vice versa. And if each reaction is labeled by a rate constant, the reaction network is said to be stochastic. And now what you do, that is typical for mathematics, and unfortunately I have to bother with you with that, but it's not very complicated actually. You define certain properties of that network, and then you check under which conditions these properties are actually relevant. So what you define first is what we call deficiency. Perhaps you can scroll a little down, and then here's deficiency. So the deficiency is the number of vertices minus the number of connected components minus the dimension of what we call the stoichiometric subspace. Well, that is a curious expression, stoichiometric, but it's simply coming from chemistry. Stoichiometric means that is the rate characteristic of the reactions involved. Yeah? Stoichiometric, it can be measured in terms of velocities, reaction velocities and all that. But how it's called is not so important. We will see after a while what it actually means. So, number of vertices minus the number of connected components minus the dimension of the stoichiometric subspace. So, in order to check this, you can see on the next page, 69, if you break that up in according to the errors, there we are. You see, that is the same reaction scheme we have here, and if you translate that, you see immediately that you have two connected components, yeah? The upper one and the lower one. So we have five vertices, yeah? The vertices are the species A, B, C, D, E, and we have two connected components. So what you have to do here is simply to determine the dimension of this stoichiometric subspace, because otherwise the deficiency would be 5 minus 2. Now it's a question, what is left? 5 minus 2 is obviously 3. So what is left? Yeah, we will find out that the dimension of the stoichiometric subspace is actually 3, and therefore the deficiency is 0. But why is that so? Because the stoichiometric subspace there of a reaction network is a subspace spent by vectors of the form x minus y, where x and y are complexes connected by a reaction. So if you apply that to A, B, C, D, E, then you see the top reactions give B minus A and A minus B. Yeah, that is obvious. But the other, the central part, gives D minus A minus C. And the lower part gives A plus C minus B minus E. And the right-hand side gives D minus B minus E. You see that are vectors of the type X minus Y. And you have simply to take all possible connections of that sort according to what kind of species you have. Yeah? So if you have A goes to B and B goes to A, then you have two of them, obviously, namely A minus B and B minus A. Yeah? So it's not actually not very complicated. We have five vectors, and these five vectors span this subspace, which is called stoichiometric subspace. But these vectors are actually linear dependent. And you remember from school that a vector space, the dimension of a vector space, is only determined by vectors that are functioning as a base because they are linear independent. So you have to put out the linear dependency here, and then you see that the space is not five-dimensional as you would expect, because we have located five vectors. But it's only three-dimensional, because two of them are linear dependent. So you have three dimensions for the stoichiometric subspace, and so 5 minus 2 minus 3 gives 0. Therefore, this reaction scheme is of deficiency 0, which is actually a very important case. And finally, we call the network weakly reversible if whenever there is a reaction going from a complex X to a complex Y, there is also a path going back. Yeah? So weakly reversible means that if you have a certain amount of arrows going from one complex to the other, then at least one arrow is coming back. So you have a back reaction, so to speak. Yeah? It's not a one-way interaction. In that case, our special network here is not weakly reversible because we can go from A plus C to D, but not back, as you can see at the top. So then we can formulate a theorem D. Yeah? That's a mission. Yeah. Given a network of this type with a finite set of species, that set is called S, suppose the deficiency is 0, then we have the two following results. First, if the network is not weakly reversible and the rate constants are positive, the rate equation does not have a positive equilibrium solution. So what does it mean? The equilibrium solution, remember, is the critical point where the structure formation is taking place. So if you have groups acting as complexes that are not weakly reversible, so that you have only one-way interaction but not a way back, then you can be sure that there will be no equilibrium. That is actually an important point. It actually means that if you have two groups and you can establish a discourse with that group such that you are putting information into this group under your own perspective, but nothing is coming back, yeah, so that the discourse is not two-sided, then you can never find an equilibrium, which is not very surprising, actually. Yeah? Now, the second point is, if the network is not weakly reversible and the rate constants are positive, the rate equation does not have a positive periodic solution. That is, a periodic solution is a repeating pattern in that. Now, important is number three. If the network is weakly reversible and the rate constants are positive, the rate equation has exactly one equilibrium solution in each positive stoichiometric compatibility class, and I will define that in a moment. The equilibrium is complex balanced. Any sufficiently nearby solution that starts in the same stoichiometric compatibility class will approach this equilibrium as t goes, time t goes to infinity. So in other words, the interesting dynamics happens in networks that have not deficiency zero. And the first condition of part three is a consequence of the fact, it's a consequence of the fact that if the stoichiometric subspace is called Stoich, yeah, and x is the solution of the rate equation, that x of t always stays within a set x0 plus this stoichiometric subspace. In other words, if you can achieve this situation, what you do is you can, independent of the boundary conditions you actually find in a particular situation, always find a solution. Solution means here that you have an interactive path between the complexes. In other words, you have communication between complexes. You can always find a path such that a certain neighborhood of the equilibrium is not left. Yeah? In other words, that is what you can reach in terms of stability. So you cannot reproduce the genuine equilibrium, but what you can do is you can approach it as far as possible, and that is the most you can get out of an interacting discourse. So now, this would actually mean that, after all, we have shown here that by a suitable discourse, namely, you have to make the discourse weakly reversible, you can achieve such a neighborhood of an equilibrium, which is called stoichiometric subspace, and the idea would be that the communication between two different groups is optimally stable if you are able to design the discourse such that you stay in that region. Yeah, that is the idea. But at the same time, you recognize that the equilibrium cannot be the pure equilibrium, that is, you cannot be optimally stable in 100% sense. And this means, in other words, that each discourse is always unstable up to a certain amount. And now there was a very brilliant Greek philosopher, Heraclitus, who once was asked, what is the appropriate strategy to achieve harmony in the political life of the polis? So what he did was, he said actually nothing at all, which was very unusual for a philosopher. But especially for a philosopher who was asked something in the ecclesia, in the assembly. Instead, what he did was he mixed the symbolic drink you had to drink when you went to the oracle in Delphi, you see, that was simply flour with some spices and water. Yeah? So you had to stir that all together, and then you had to drink it. So Heraclitus mixed that drink, stirred it, drank it, and left the room. Yeah? So that was his answer. And the question is, what did he mean? Well, the idea was the following. He said, the society of the polis is actually very much like that drink, because it's mixed from different parts, and these parts will dissolve if you don't stir them, because otherwise they won't mix properly. So what you have in order to be able to drink properly is you have to stir that all the time. In other words, the society of the polis must be stirred, meaning must remain in motion all the time, because that is the stability you can reach at most. Yeah, it's a kind of dynamical, unstable stability, so to speak. And this is due to the fact that the parts of which the drink or the groups of which the city is made are so different. Otherwise, you have either the complete dissolution of the drink, then you cannot drink it properly because it's very difficult. But by stirring, you can actually achieve a mixture which is dynamically stable rather than completely unstable. So, this result is actually the formal expression in mathematical terms of what Heraclitus has said. So if you have a living quarter with very many different groups, as I've shown you in that example of the district in Berlin, then what you have to do is to create a discourse such that there is a kind of permanently stirring all these various components, and if you achieve that in a properly structured rhythm, what you can do is to have the stability which is possible. And in formal terms, this possible stability is actually the neighborhood of the equilibrium solution to the master equation of all these Pigou-Net representations. And as we have seen, if you try to achieve this in a mathematical way, then of course you have to utilize a computer because you have so many groups and you have to calculate very large transition matrices and all that. But in principle, this can be done in that way. So that is what I would have to say. Once more, in terms of the city models we have achieved here. And finally, I would like to show you page 144. So, because now we have said everything with regard to our idea of modeling and applying this type of modeling to the special problem of living quarters in the city, but now comes the metaphysical restriction of that, which is actually leading us back to the introducing remarks we had with respect to Lamont Rule and Spinoza, up to Spinoza and Leibniz. Now, we have talked here about observed phenomena, that is actually the world we are dealing with. And origin of metaphysical questions lies in the fact that from the beginning on there is a difference between what can be observed and what is actually there. And one of that is called substance and the other is called subject, or in the Aristotelian notation it's called ousia, that is substance, and hypokeimenon, which is subject. So the difference between the two is that substance is what there is in reality, but which cannot be observed completely, while subject is what you can observe, but what therefore can be only the observable part of substance. And that is actually the restriction which is important for human beings, because human beings are such that they can only observe what they can observe according to their perceptive capacity, yeah? Meaning to their sensory perception in optical, acoustical and other terms. So now remember that the equation we had with regard to pyramids was a Schrödinger type equation, only settled in real space, but the quantum equation is settled in complex space but has a similar form, which is actually shown above, and psi is a probability amplitude here for a certain physical state. And the probability that a physical system obtains a certain state or settles in a certain state is actually the square of the absolute value of this psi, yeah? Psi absolute squared. So that was the difference as compared to the Schrödinger version we had with respect to Petri-Nets. So now this curious notation there, this is due to Mr. Dirac, who was a famous physicist in England, and this is this part here, this is called a cat. And the cat, that is this sign here with a line and this triangle, which is a kind of half bracket, so to speak. This is demonstrating that psi is a state of the system, or rather the probability of that. Now, the point is that you have essentially two possibilities, because that is a vector, so it's a state vector, and in case of vectors you have two possibilities to form products, namely either in terms of a scalar product or in terms of what we call a cross product. So what you can do is to form something like that, or to form something like that. And this is the scalar product. So the scalar product of two vectors, and this is called a bra, so both together is called a bracket. So it's New English. And this scalar product is a number, obviously. And this is a matrix. That is a cross product. Now that is parallel to what you know about vectors from school. So now, particularly for one such psi, we see that the form is the same. The Hamiltonian, what is called Hamiltonian here, Hamiltonian operator, is actually what in former times we called the transition matrix. Yeah, that is the same. So, What we have here is what we call a density operator. A density operator is obviously that exterior or cross product, which is a matrix, and it has appropriate coefficients. So this expression, C, J, C, K are complex numbers. C star is a conjugate complex. And this is the exterior product of the psi states. And the result, summing over all possible J, K, is actually what we call the density operator. So now the important point is that in quantum mechanics you start from the idea of quantum coherence, and you see that it's a question of perspective, because if you have a macroscopic body which is a large object, and this object is due to classical physics, then you can measure the location of this object only by shining light on it, yeah, obviously, because you have to see it in the first place, otherwise you couldn't see where it is. But seeing it means that there is light which is reflected such that it's falling into your eyes, yeah, so photons, yeah, light particles, are actually coming up to this, and they are reflected, and this is the reason why we actually see it, and we can say there at this location there's an object. And of course in classical physics you would not expect that these small photons here, that they would influence the motion or the location of this large body. Yeah? Because the idea of classical physics is that everything which is small can be neglected with respect to what you are actually interested in. So in fact, this would be a perturbation which is negligible. But in quantum mechanics, it's actually the other way around. We have the same situation, but now you say that what is transported here is coherence. And coherence means that all possible states are entangled such that you cannot differ which state is belonging to which object. Yeah? So, if you characterize an object as a set of physical states, then if you cannot actually associate one particular state with one particular object, then of course you don't know to which object this measured state is actually belonging. And there is actually a limit to coherence, which is something around the electron. And this is a very famous experiment performed by Feynman, who was a student of Einstein, actually, and one of the last students of Einstein. And Feynman has done what we call the two-slit experiment. In fact, this lecture course can be seen in YouTube. Yeah? So in original, Feynman speaking, which is quite an event, and he is explaining to you the two-slit experiment. And this is as follows. You have a screen with two slits open, and you have here an electron emitter which is shooting electrons onto this screen. And obviously the electrons go to one screen or through the other, through one slit or the other. And here you have a screen which is actually counting the hits of electrons on the target. Now what you would expect if the electrons are what you suppose them to are, namely small particles, they go either through slit A or through slit B. And if they do so, after a while, you would have such a distribution of measured hits. Because obviously when you are in the direction of the slit, then there will be a maximum, because most of them will go through the slits and the others, but some of them might be somehow in the middle or so, but the peaks of the intensity will be according to the slits. That is the case if the electron would be a particle, because a particle is like a little ball, you know, going through one or the other. Now, if you have a water wave here instead, you would expect something else, because a water wave would produce interferences behind the slit. That is quite clear, because the waves, you know, when they are breaking at an obstacle, they would superimpose, and obviously then you had a different pattern. So what you would have here is more some kind which is looking something like this. So in between here are all the interfering parts of the waves. So now the important point is that in fact you find an interference pattern rather than particle pattern. So that was the reason to say that elementary particles can be visualized as particles but at the same time as waves. And this can be actually seen in formal terms, because you see E is approximately mc squared, where the energy is equal to the mass times the square of the velocity of light. But at the same time, it's h times nu, where nu is the frequency of the radiation, and h is Planck's constant. So that, in fact, you could argue that because the wavelength times the frequency is the velocity of light, you are actually dealing either with particles or at the same time with waves. So that is called the particle-wave duality in quantum physics. But that is not the important point, because you would say, oh well, that is a particularity in quantum mechanics. If you take one electron, and nowadays one is actually able to be sure that you are only shooting one electron onto the screen, then obviously the choice is either A or B. But nevertheless, you have an interference pattern. That means one electron interferes with itself. So in other words, if one electron is producing an interference pattern, this means that the electron is going through both slits at the same time. Yeah? And that is, of course, very curious. But it's only curious because we are somewhat restricted persons. Yeah? Because the electron, of the size of the electron, is just at the boundary of coherence. So coherence, if it means that each state is entangled with other states and you cannot sort out which state is belonging to which particle, then it's quite natural that the result would be that one electron is going to through two slits at the same time, because you cannot sort out which part of the electron is practically representing which state. Yeah, so for coherent people that would be quite clear. But we are decoherent people, meaning we have to differ between single objects, and therefore for us this is a puzzle. Yeah? And even worse, Because if I put a detector here, so that the detector is sitting at the slit and waiting for the electron to come or not, then suddenly this interference pattern disappears. And I can say, oh, the electron has gone through slit number A or number B as to that. So in other words, our observation is determining the outcome of the measurement. Or in other words, the electron is behaving differently according to whether we observe it or not, which is quite curious. Yeah? But the point is, if you think in coherent terms, namely in the irreducibility of single states, then that is quite clear from the outset. But we are used to classical physics. Human beings are beings of classical physics because we act in a certain order of magnitude. Everything we have to do with and we can grasp with our hands and we can see and hear is of a size which is very large as compared to an electron. And in that region, above the size of an electron, there comes in what we call decoherence. And coming back to this large object, it actually means that the photons falling onto the object, which we are utilizing in order to determine the rotation of which, are taking away from this object information, namely the photons which are dispersed in the environment, take away information about the location of the object. And by doing so, they take away coherence. And the result is the contrary, decoherence. Decoherence means that all interference terms are damped out to zero, and what is left is a real object, is one real object. So that in classical terms I can say, oh, there at this place with given coordinates, there is a single object. So I can actually differ at all. I can differ between this object and this object. Yeah? I can say they have two different locations at the same time, and they are obviously different because they have a boundary and all that. But in quantum terms, that would not be true. We could not say what is what, because all would be a kind of soup of coherence, because the physical states are equally distributed, and we could not say which state is belonging to which object. So, in other words, you can realize now that this conception of quantum coherence is actually very similar to what Spinoza would have thought of substance, because the real world is a world of coherence, but the world we observe is a world of decoherence, because otherwise we couldn't orient ourselves. Yeah? We have to differ between locations, space, time, and so on, single objects, meta-objects. Because if that would not be the case, we could not orient ourselves completely, because coherent means that everything is distributed somewhere. But this is exactly as we could illustrate substance nowadays in modern terms. Spinoza was a very great fan of mathematics because he was a fan of Descartes. He would have been happy to have this mathematics available, but unfortunately he had not. But we now can utilize this in order to conceptualize the concept of substance in a more tangible way as compared to the general definition in terms of negativity, you know, absence of space and time and so on and so on. You see that this is nevertheless true for our model, because quantum coherence means that you do not have space and time, because you cannot differ between locations, you see. So now what's the metaphysical point here of restriction is that All we have said so far in terms of modeling is a pure human invention. So it's only working because communication is producing a consensus about what is useful and what is not useful, and the orientation point is simply the functioning of concepts. But this does not mean that we are dealing with the real truth of the world, you see, and that is unfortunately something we can never reach, because we are actually restricted to our sensory perceptions. And even if we develop very abstract models of mathematics in terms of quantum coherence or whatsoever, we nevertheless still use the old categories of classical physics, because we are still talking all the time about space, time, object matter, and so on. And we can obviously not dissolve our language from these categories. So this is the reason why we are restricted to the modeling of observable space, which is only a tiny part, and therefore we have not to wonder that from time to time we have a major shift in ideas, because then things are practically uncovered, which have been covered so far by looking at the thing without actually recognizing it. Yeah? That is a kind of point of warning, after all, when you do a lot of modeling, as I've shown that in the lecture notes. So this would be practically the conclusion of this lecture course, and well, I thank you all for your presence and hope that it was not too difficult after all. As I said, you have, of course, to count on your own reading. In other words, it's unlikely that you will have understood everything what I said before you have read the lecture notes and the papers I mentioned. Of course, you have not to read all of them, that is quite clear, but it would be helpful to ponder a while about the lecture notes in order to come more into the details. And as I announced in the beginning, please don't hesitate to send me an email if you have a question or any other problem later on when I'm not more present here in Lyon. But you can reach me anyway by email, and I will be happy to discuss one or the other question for you according to your